Welcome to Almost Here, Around the Corner of Future Technology Podcasts with Richard Jacobs. Future technologies poised to transform our lives for better or worse are the focus of this podcast. Almost here means these technologies are now here and starting to be used. We're just around the corner, from Bitcoin to artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more.
Hello and welcome to Future Tech Podcast. I'm your host, Juliet Lamar, and joining us today, we have Dr. Panta Sutardja. He is the founder at Latticeworks Incorporated. Welcome, Panta.
Well, thank you, Juliet.
I'm so happy that you're taking the time to join us here today because you've got a lot of exciting things to talk about.
Sure. Yes, we would like to talk about my new venture, Latticeworks Inc. And hopefully we get some words out there for people to be aware of what we're doing.
So why don't you go ahead and give us an overview of Latticeworks Inc.
Okay. So where does it start? I think I'll just say about a little bit about what my interest was and how we get into this. And So basically, I was in the storage business, in the chip side of the storage business, and I always wanted to get into the system side of it. And we see that the cloud storage is really where the growth is. Existing enterprise storage is very large, but it's pretty much stagnant. So as a startup, it would be prudent to get into something that is growing instead of something that is big but stagnant, right? So suddenly, I'm looking at cloud as a platform, but I have always had some lingering concern about how cloud is deployed, executed today. Basically, all the existing cloud service providers, they all pretty much want to suck all your data into their cloud. While they provide really very good services, a lot of convenience, I always feel somewhat uncomfortable that I give away the most private part of, my content, everything, right? Whether I intend to share or not, I'll be putting into the cloud. Say, is it safe? I always have that lingering concern. So the decision was why not put ownership of the data in the hand of the consumer themselves, right? But also give the convenience that they have come to expect that the cloud provides. As privacy has become something that is very much in everybody's mind because of recent abuse cases. But the truth is that when consumers are only given, two choices, they have to choose one, whether they have to pick either convenience or privacy. They overwhelmingly basically choose convenience, right? I mean, I don't think people are really that naive that says that, oh, the cloud is definitely not going to be, leaking the data and things like that. Bad things can happen. Not that the cloud service provider intends to, but it happens. Sometimes they did intend to because you are on a social networking platform that only use advertising as their revenue source. Of course, your data will definitely be actively mined. I don't think people really don't know about that. They just hope that nothing bad will happen. But it's been proven that all those were wishful thinking. And the reason we built Latticeworks, the kind of platform we're building, is to basically sidestep all these issues. I will give the consumer control of the data by saying that you keep your data. However, I will give you all the other services, the connectivity, and all the sharing capability, and all the services that you're used to having from the cloud service provider. That in a nutshell, at the very, very simplistic view, what we are trying to be different from the other cloud service providers.
And I was going to say, what are some of the main issues that you encounter with cloud storage that you're concerned about, and how are you specifically tackling those issues with Latticeworks?
First of all, if you look at the amount of data that consumers are generating, it is mostly your photos and videos, and going more and more into videos. matter how big your cell phone storage is, you know, we started with 32 gig, 64 gig, 128, and 256. It's never enough. So, you know, the common experience that, you know, people have is that they just keep filling up their storage, right? So one common solution that they have is, well, let's just store it in Google Photo, for example, or Apple iCloud. Now, with Google Photo, the nice thing is that it's mostly free if you allow them to downsize your image. But to me, that's kind of crazy because people buy the latest gadget, the latest smartphone having the best camera, you know, very high resolution pictures and videos. Yet the only thing they save will be in, you know, much lower resolution as if they have a camera that is, you know, 3-4 years old. So to me, that really does not make sense. Paid services like iCloud or Dropbox, Google Drive, they will keep your stuff in original resolution, but it's more expensive. And, you know, there's always that concern that, you know, if things are in the hands in the cloud, massive amount of data in the cloud, they are really a great target for hackers, right? It's not that the cloud service providers intend to let things get leaked up, but bad things happen because they are the aggregation point for all the data. So a hit, you know, a successful hack will access a lot of data. So in my view, a much more distributed system where we spread every user's data in their own home will make the system more robust, first because there are too many targets to hit by any hacker. Secondly, we can provide two level of protection. The first level of protection is that the device themselves will self-protect and prevent somebody from hacking in. The second level is that the connected cloud service where all access have to first go through is our cloud, and we will provide one more level of protection. So by doing so, we are making things harder to hack into, and we are making the data much less attractive for somebody to hack into, simply because of the scale of large numbers, right? They're too spread out. You don't know which one is worth hacking into. Now, I'm not saying that anybody can guarantee that software has no bugs. Everybody tried to use a lot of open source software to build up their system. We're not any different. But what I'm saying is that there are ways to improve things by having certain policies, making things less attractive to be hacked, doing exactly the same thing the other guys do to make sure that even if they know you are the target, it will be difficult to hack, and adding more layer of protection. That's the kind of approach that we're taking. It's a multi-pronged approach, not a single way of protecting your data.
And having multiple ways to protect the data is, you know, you're attacking the problem from multiple angles. So it's going to provide many different solutions for a single problem. Give us a little insight into your product, Amber.
So actually, I don't think we don't want to oversell the part that is the privacy part, right? It is something that we consider, you know, the right of the user. Really, we have to solve a problem for the user, for people to pick up a product. The way I see it is that the biggest pain points that consumers are facing today is that their cell phone become full all the time, very quickly. My own experience is that whatever I start with, you know, I have a 64 gigabyte cell phone, you know, I will use it all, you know, 70-80% up in the first year, and the second year, third year on, I will be self throttling and say, wow, I only have, you know, 30% left, 10% left, 5% left. I start to slow down how I use my device. To me, that's kind of crazy because that's simply because I have no good way of backing up my data. If I do back it up, I always have run into problem where how do I re-access it? It's very, very common that when you go to some kind of social settings, you want to show somebody some pictures, photos from a year ago, you find that it's out of your cell phone memory. It's in somewhere in your backup device that you have a hard time finding. We want to solve all those issues for the consumers, right? I mean, those are the most direct pain points that consumer will relate to. And we're saying that, oh, by the way, we're doing it in such a way that it is going to protect your privacy a lot better than what the cloud guys, the pure cloud guys can provide. So that is our most important use case for consumers. But of course, we won't stop there, right? When you create a lot of data, you need to have ability to share. You know, by being a full cloud service, we allow people to do sharing to anybody in the cloud. And we also try to add, facial recognition indexing, so it is easy to sift through your photo and video collection to find things. Not many people really have the patience to go through one picture at a time or one video at a time when they want to look for something. This is really another pain point that most people have. We can help them by providing the thing, you know, similar type of AI functionality that the existing cloud guys are providing.
Very cool, because that is, you know, with all this content comes the need to search and to sort through all of it, which can take a long astronomical amount of time. So simplifying that process is definitely going to give you bonus points with consumers.
Definitely.
I was just going to ask for you to give us a little of your background so our audience can understand a little bit more of where you came from and how you got to this point.
That would be a long story, so if you don't mind, I'll just give you a short form of that. I have been an electronics hobbyist since I was around 12 years old, but I'm not the traditional hobbyist where I only hacked on things that I like. I am one of the few who will be willing to learn something new if that is a prerequisite for my original interest. So, throughout my educational years from, 12 years old through my college years, most of the time I spent on other things. The prerequisites for learning any subject, technical subject like electronics, will be physics, math, and a bunch of other things. I was just learning all those other subjects most of the time because I knew that, they're going to be needed to be good at what I wanted to do. So even after I graduated, let me just roll back a little bit. When I was at doing my PhD, I was not even doing circuits. I was doing process and process simulation, which is a lot of software programming and numerical analysis and things like that. When I first got my first job at IBM, I was assigned a job to do magnetic recording. If you look back throughout my years, I've been doing a lot of different things, learning a lot of different things that seems to be random, but the way I see it is that it strengthened my overall technical background. And I look back and see that that whole process, the most important thing that a trait that I acquired, I think has to be learning to build tools that I need for my job, whatever that is. So from 12 years old to 30 years old before I started Marvell, that's almost 20 years. I've been going through a journey where I learned and worked on many different things. It took really almost two decades for me to circle back when I get back to Marvell, started Marvell to doing heavy-duty circuit design again. And I think the previous experience that I built, that I acquired really helped me in that process. I'm not doing things simply at the micro level. Doing chips seems like a very detailed design, but I could look at more at the system side, what the chip is going to be used in and what the requirement of those bigger systems And I think that gives us a distinct advantage over our competitors. Basically, we went from, a startup at the time that we started with 12, 13, 14 other competitors. And by at the end of it, today we have only two storage chip companies for hard disk drives. Marvell is the biggest one. So, and I think the kind of system-minded view that we have really helped us put us into that position. But ultimately, I like system too much, and I wanted to do more in systems. That's how I decided that I have to leave Marvell to really form a system company. But my decision to go after system is go directly to consumers. And that's how I founded Latticeworks to build something that is different enough but can leverage some of the knowledge that I've built up over the years in the storage space, and build a platform that is it's really a big system. It's what the consumer needs, and we can expand the services further from there. Once you have the data, you can do a lot of other things, like artificial intelligence, really helping the consumers sift through their data, make their data useful. Our motto is really, and our tagline is really make your data active, really replay life. We say that your data is your life, your memory, and it should not be put into cold storage. You should relive it, and the only way to do that is to make the data readily available, easily accessed by yourself, and easily shared to anybody.
Yeah, absolutely. So, how, what is the user experience when they come and they want to start using your product?
So we try to make things as simple for the user as possible. If you look at why cloud is so easy to use, it's because you just sign up, enter your account and password and a few validation steps, and you're good to go, right?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, with owning a hardware at home, you have a few more steps you have to do, but it is still pretty much the most time-consuming part is still identifying the ownership. The account name, the passwords, and things like that for the owner, and any sub accounts for the family members. After that, all the rest that use the device will simply need to sign up to a cloud account. We will bind the local account to the cloud account, and for people that own the Ember device, the device that we sell, they will bind their local account to their cloud account to make the cloud service the Ember device in terms of sharing and things like that. For all other users, all they need is their cloud account, and they will be able to receive shares from anybody else, whether it is in the cloud or whether coming a file, a photo, video coming from an Ember device from someone else. They all show up in a single account, right? I just need, basically, from a consumer point, I just need to log into my cloud account and I see everything. I see all the information from anybody. I will be able to share something back using that portal to anybody else. So the use model is pretty much the same as a traditional cloud service use model. Whether you're at home, whether you're on the go, it looks the same thing. All the heavy lifting are done behind the scene by our cloud service. We will connect, to the data that somebody shared to you automatically behind the scene.
Wow, very, very great. And so if someone wants to learn more about Latticeworks Inc., to learn more about Ember, what's the best place to find information and to get connected?
We have our website, myamberlife.com. That's M-Y-A-M-B-E-R lifecom. We will put a lot more information as we go on. Right now, there's some information in there. You can also sign up to learn more. As we, you know, we will be able to contact you. If you have certain interests, we will be able to contact you. Otherwise, you know, you will find more and more information on the website. You can also watch some of our marketing video on YouTube. If you just search Amber Replay Live, you'll find our video. Look at it. It's a kind of interesting video to show, you know how people relate to their memories and will use the device. You know, hopefully you'll find it to be useful. And certainly, we are still adding more content to our website. So you know, keep coming to our website to look for more information. And we're planning to launch a product. A pre-sale campaign by Friday this week.
Very exciting.
Yes. So, you know, we're not a typical startup. We've been running this for almost 4 years now. We are not trying to, you know, we're not using somebody's money to fund our R&D. We do that ourselves. We just want to give people a heads up, an early reservation capability. We're basically planning to ship a product in October timeframe.
Everyone will be on the lookout for that, for sure. Dr. Pantas, thank you so much for joining us today on Future Tech Podcast.
Well, thank you very much, Juliet.
That is Dr. Pantas Sutardja. He is the founder of Latticeworks, Inc. Thank you all so much for joining us here today on Future Tech Podcast. I've been your host, Juliet Lamar. Catch you guys next time.
You have been listening to Almost Here, Around the Corner Future Technology Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Subscribe to this podcast, post to review, to discover more future technologies that are poised to transform our lives for better or worse, such as Bitcoin, artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more.